What we'll do is we'll straight off get into the panel, but we have a very dear friend of mine, Rahul Gangal, who's actually going to be the master of ceremony here. But before I forget, next year Porter Prize is on 29th September, and we'll tell you the location at a later date. But Rahul, over to you, please.
Thank you, Amit. You left me with two challenges today. You left me with the death session, which was just after lunch, and now you left me with the very pleasurable task of conducting this August gathering over the evening today. So Amit has introduced that we would start with two panel discussions. Let's look at the first one. The first panel discussion focuses on capitalism, shared value, and social progress, three themes which have traditionally been thought of as independent, but we believe they are interwoven. So we believe capitalism, shared value, and social progress can coexist harmoniously. To help us understand this theme, and I would request the following people to come on stage in this order. I would request Dr. Shelley Batra, the CEO of Operation Asha, to please make her way to the stage. Shelley, if you're around, please. Yes. Ladies and gentlemen, a big hand for Dr. Shelley Batra. I would then request Mr. Anil Jain, the Managing Director of Jain Irrigation, to please make his way to the stage. Mr. Sumantra Sen, the CEO of JSW Foundation, to please make his way. Mr. Deepak Arora, Group Head, CSR, and CEO of SR Foundation, to be there. Satya Saurabh, the Managing Director for Adimod Translation, Transnational Trading, LLC, please, to make his way. Now, with this audience, you have a panel that represents large groups, JSW, SR. It represents large projects like Operation Asha. It represents players who have carved a very specific place for themselves in large ventures like Jain Irrigation. Building a clear sense of shared value, they would talk about how the concept is going beyond social responsibility and how it would enhance organizations' ability to contribute to communities on a sustainable basis. This panel would be moderated by Sukumar Ranganathan, who's the editor for Mint. So let's have him on stage as well. Sukumar, over to your capable hands now.
I'm going to set things rolling. It says capitalism, shared value, social progress. Shelley, do they even go together?
I hope I can.
Can you hear her? You can? Okay, because I can't, but that's all right.
I think capitalism, shared value, and social progress, they not only go together, they are an inextricable part of each other. And I will explain how. What I feel is that in a society that is not capitalistic, let's think of the communist era, the erstwhile Soviet Union, I don't think there was any drive and any initiative to do anything. And compare that now with India, with the economy, with the industry growing, the big boom, and lots of things happening. That is what leads to shared value and improves prosperity, social growth, social prosperity. And if you ask me how and why, I'm a doctor by profession, I'm not a finance person, but as I see all around, whatever work we do, if the benefits can percolate to the bottom of the pyramid, to the poorest of the poor, that is what shared value is all about. And that is what capitalism does for us. Now, when I started my private practice, I left the government hospital. I was in a very big fancy hospital, and everyone said, the hospital is making money and the doctors are earning a huge amount. No doubt that is true. But at the same time, there were jobs created for the people doing the gardening, doing the laundry, cleaning the toilets, the technicians, and so many other people. And these people, when they get jobs, they have food on the table. The children go to school, they have money for health benefits. And that is how they are lifted out of poverty. And I think that is what shared prosperity is all about. Social progress, if you were to ask me, what is my view of social progress? Well, I would say that what are the social determinants of health? If these determinants are changing for the better, then that is social progress, and I would say capitalism does that very, very effectively, more than any other form of government. Let me give you an example. I visited Tata Nagar, Jamshedpur, and everyone was talking of the Tatas doing wonderful work and huge factories and huge jobs. And there's one more thing I noticed. around the Tata factory, there were many small ancillary industries that had cropped up. So for the rolling mill, someone was making something else that was used in the rolling mill. It could be little plastic cups to serve tea to everybody. And that is how I feel we can promote the well-being and we can promote social progress just by doing what we are good at. Our own individual work, whether we are professors, whether we are corporates, whether we are hospitals or the government, if we find we are working, if we agree, we are working towards a common goal, that of promoting a more equitable distribution of health and wealth. Well, I think the way we can do it is the way I've just described and the way all corporates are doing.
Okay, thank you. Does everyone agree with her? Other than me, like, of course. Yeah. I mean,
I'd just like to add that while it is true that they definitely should be actually, you know, closely linked to each other, I guess this model of, you know, shared value and how, you know, how they talk to each other and all is still evolving. If I look at social progress, for example, it has possibly, both from a private sector standpoint as well as others, is that it's also been having its own goals, own vertical, own growth. It's only now that we are talking about shared value by design. So far, what has happened is that that vertical has pursued its own goals. Maybe some spillover or some add-on additional benefits.
Not even that. I personally feel it's very paternalistic, whatever has happened so far. Right? It's like, that's how Indian companies work, right? You sin for much of the year, and then once a year you go and have a bath in the Ganges and it's fine. The same way you set up a foundation or you do something. So it's all very, I'm sorry, I know there are two people from a foundation here, but it's very paternalistic. Whereas this topic seems to suggest that there is some amount of structure in it, some amount of science in it. Yeah. I basically am trying to understand whether you're beginning to see that change.
Yeah, that's precisely where I think that things are changing now. You know, I can see that, and see, it doesn't have to change suddenly. For example, the responsible corporate behavior or CSR, the way we understand in this country, it doesn't suddenly have to change its goals and try to see that, can I add that goal, can I add business goal? No. I think what it can focus on is what it is doing, sharpen that further, see that there is an alignment to a purpose, not get carried away by too many things, focus on certain things, align that better, and also align with the other things like responsible business behavior, which is coming, like sustainability or other things, how your business model itself, you know, respects some sustainable development. So that's I think is where an opportunity lies there. But I would not say that the model is completely evolved. Some of us are seeing a lot of integration there, and have seen the benefits also, both from, let's say, brand reputation as well as, you can call it mitigation of risk. We've seen that change happen.
My own experience, sitting in the sidelines, of course, has been that the evolution is near perfect as long as it doesn't clash with any business objective, right? The minute it clashes with business objectives, obviously we all know what comes first, right? I mean, there is quarterly pressure on companies and there are things that they'll have to worry about. Mines are more important than forests, right?
I beg to differ.
All right.
So, in my mind, the capitalism, the social progress, creating shared value need not be add-on and need not be in conflict with your profit-making objectives. So I think that's the wrong premise.
I'm going to interrupt you because I don't know how many of you know about Jain Irrigation, which in many ways is an exceptional company in how it works with people. So at the end of whatever you have to say now, I think you should also tell them a little bit about how you work and how you built this organization.
Okay, sure. So, when I talk about, or we talk about creating shared value, that is not in exclusion of our profit-making objectives. We actually believe that creating shared value and creating disproportionate value for your stakeholders, especially our major stakeholder is a farmer and agriculture community with whom we deal with, is the only way we can make more profits, can sustain ourselves for a longer term and create sustainable growth. So we believe in development. We believe, but development also has to be sustainable, and not sustainable just in terms of, let's say, whether your stakeholders are creating value or not. But what about the earth? What about the natural resources? Everything on one hand. On the other hand, the processes you follow, the objectives you have, those all have to be aligned and fair. And it is not communism or socialism, it's not about equitable distribution. It's about creating value in a manner so that everybody can share it, but then that person also deserves that value. It's not that you're doing him, as you said, paternalistic. So you're not doing him a favor by doing what you're doing. You know, you are actually, everybody's acting in self-interest, you know, because unless you act in self-interest, you will not survive, grow, sustain yourself. So that's a first part of the human DNA, is to sustain yourself. And the third part of this, in terms of social progress, is that when you create this kind of a value creation with the help of capitalism, then the social progress happens, because then it becomes a model sustainable. So it's not a model that where in 1 year a foundation goes and helps a group of people for a given thing, but the next year the foundation is not there, they go back to the same thing. And I also want to come back quickly to this whole concept of bottom of the pyramid. Professor Prahlad, who talked about bottom of pyramid, a lot of people has taken that to mean that, okay, there is much larger market of poor people whom we would not otherwise go to, and now we have ability to go to these people because we should also focus, and we can create a 1 rupee, you know, sachet of a shampoo or anything like that. In my mind, that is not really way to address bottom of the pyramid, because what you're creating is more consumption for these people, but without necessarily creating their ability to pay for it in terms of productivity gains or in terms of value creation. So at least what, as a company, what we have focused upon is dealing with the small farmers. And these farmers are, let's say, 1 acre to 2 acre, 3 acre, very small farmers. These farmers have been in a perpetual vicious cycle of poverty and debt for centuries together. But look at their commitment, that they have continued to do the same profession because they do not know anything else. And they think this is preordained, this is what their life is about. Generally speaking, if you go to US, West and everywhere else, the thought process is that agriculture, to be efficient and to be value creation, must be large, must be consolidation. But we have worked on a concept that in India, reality is small farmers exist, and there are 12 crore small farmers. So we can take that small farmer and make him a very productive and sustainable member of the society by giving him knowledge, access to technology in a manner where we make money. But when, let's say, if I sell to a farmer 100,000 rupees of drip irrigation system, maybe I make 7,000 rupees. But I'm ensuring that farmer every year is making another 100,000 or 200,000 for next 7-8 years. And that's what I talk about, creating disproportionate value for him. And apart from creating that value, then what he grows, we are buying from him. You know, there's a long story of what we do with them. But today, we have reached out to more than 5 million farmers, and these farmers today are, their, you know, sons and daughters are becoming engineers or doctors or whatever else profession they want to pursue. They have a pakka home, and they are willing to invest into agriculture. Otherwise, a challenge for our country in next decade or two with a massive urbanization, who is going to grow food anymore?
All right. So I noticed that you didn't want to say anything about your own company. We will come back to that, because I will ask you a couple of questions. I know Deepak wants to say something. He was looking very uncomfortable when I said mines. Right, so
I think all of us understand that aspect, that business is really an integral part of the global economy. And to put things in perspective, if you look at the top 10, 20, 30 companies, they will probably have their revenues which are in excess of GDP of many countries. So I think business is there, and it's an integral part of whatever we do. And at the same time, I think the important aspect also to understand is that it is not a zero-sum game. And businesses are an integral part of the society. There are resources that the companies leverage upon, and there are also contribution that the companies make back to the society, be it in the form of a consumption. So it's a cycle. So if in a cycle you pull out a certain element, then the cycle itself becomes incomplete. I think the question why this debate is going on, and it's not a new debate. In fact, if you read George Bernard Shaw, he wrote a play called Major Barbara, which was almost 100 years back. And he spoke about the same conflict of a corporate versus the social, where the father is an arms and ammunition manufacturer and the daughter is a social worker. And she continues this debate that you are making bad money. So I think that debate lives on. So today, when we look at this perspective of capitalism, I think the point of beginning is when we realize the power dimension of it, and we tend to look at that aspect of the company more than the legitimacy part of it. And if you really look at the example which Mr. Jain took, now it is a disaggregated farm practices which are there, and there are disaggregated farms which are there. So that aggregation perspective has been integrated into a business theme. I think that is the value proposition which lies. And similarly, there are plenty of examples across the country. There are many that I can quote. Nestle did it very well in Punjab when they were trying to build their capabilities of setting up a milk powder plant. And the examples just go on. So it's not that these things are not possible where you can minimize the negative impacts and maximize the positive impact. I think there has to be a greater thoughtfulness into this entire process, and it has to be made more normative rather than a short-term thought on this is what I will do. India, I could agree with what you say, because we are actually suffering from that myopic view, because it's not that mining has not been happening. Mining has been happening in India for thousands of years, but the lives of people who are living in those mining areas, it hasn't changed. So there is something which is structurally wrong. If it was so easy or so possible, then probably even before the corporate sector really set in, things would have happened. And I often take examples in a place called Dantewada where we work. The iron ore extraction railway track has been there for 100 years. It still doesn't have a railway track for moving the passengers. It doesn't have. So I think there are some fundamental structural issues which are there, because of which this discussion between power and legitimacy, it just continues to grow. And we also have to allow the Indian corporate sector, especially in the CSR space, is evolving. We have suddenly, the expectations have moved from gear 1 to gear 5. It is not really matched with adequate resource, knowledge, capabilities to be able to perform that well. I really see a lot of change in coming 5 years, where we will see examples where pioneering projects, something like what Gates Foundation does across the world, we may see that very soon, that a new concept, a new idea which is not recognized by anyone, it is a latent thought, a latent challenge, but then there are corporates who will pick it up. So I see that happening in time to come.
Satya, your thoughts, and then we'll move on to the next round.
I think the issue that has been raised, the interlinkage issue, is central to the survival of the civilization. And we are at a point in history where industrial revolution has been going on for 250 years. Yet society has all kinds of conflicts. It's not just the gap between the top and the bottom. The issue that has been raised is central to the survival of our civilization. To understand this issue, it may be useful to go back to our conception of capitalism. Our conception of capitalism, as we all understand it, goes back to Adam Smith and the Industrial Revolution. There are three ideas which are central to our understanding. Capitalism allows individual freedom, and in maximizing our personal gain through an invisible hand, the gain of society is also maximized. This is the understanding with which we are all working. Regulation comes from outside the system, the government, they have regulators. Something in this understanding is not working. Therefore, the dynamic balance that capitalism is supposed to create and sustain itself, that dynamic balance is resulting in a kind of permanent imbalance. That is the concern. How do we overcome this? My personal take on it is that we can learn from the European Renaissance. The European Renaissance happened because the thinkers felt that maybe what was said thousands of years ago, maybe what Aristotle said, Socrates said, maybe there was some sense in it. And they tried to integrate it with whatever is the most modern thinking that was available at that time. And they created a new university. It led to an upsurge in art, architecture, followed by a spate of inventions, discoveries, and industrial development. However, again, the way was lost and problems started happening. My take on it is as follows, that if we integrate our modern thinking, whatever Michael Porter is saying, with ancient wisdom and understand capitalism from that point of view, we will understand both strategy, capitalism, and add to value and productivity. Do I have time to elaborate?
We'll come back to you. Yeah, thank you. I think you raised a very valid point, because this is obviously something to which a lot of people have tried to find answers. You find a lot of concepts that have come out. Shared value is one of them. Conscious capitalism is another.
Correct, is the other,
right?
One.
Which Whole Foods, for instance, does.
And Whole Foods.
And the unfortunate thing is,
Rosabeth Cantor has done
it. It is very
work.
Controversial also, because Whole Foods is Whole Foods, right? I mean, there are issues, right, in terms of wages, in terms of sourcing, in terms of people who go out of business, because Whole Foods is to its segment, in some ways, I know it's an odious comparison, what Walmart is to big retail. And so there are much smaller outlets which go out of business every time Whole Foods opens in a market. And so it is pretty controversial in its own way.
Yet Michael Porter quotes him.
Yeah, I know. So the job of, I think, conscious journalism is not to believe everything that you read in books, right? It's to also ask questions about various
But also
things.
Look at the work of Rosabeth Cantor.
Yeah.
She's done a lot of work in companies which contributed towards the tsunami.
That's right.
And she has a lot of models there.
So the question I have to the panel, and you know, anyone should feel free to butt in, and anyone should feel free to, I mean, interrupt and everything else, is two parts. The first one, Indian companies and Indian entrepreneurs in general, if you look at, let's say you leave out the last 5 years and you look at the period before that, I've done a pretty bad job when it comes to philanthropy and charity and everything else, because we don't give as much as any other business community anywhere else in the world does, right? So, which is accepted, right? It's there, it's enshrined, there's data, everything else, it shows and all that. And it's changing, right? It's changing in many ways. It's changed over the last 5 years. Has it become institutionalized in some way? Or is what we are seeing now merely a response to what the government tried to put in place? I know it's not mandatory, but the very fact that you have to maintain some records and at some point in time they might be called into question, is that what is making companies change? Or do you, and let's start with you again, Shelley, do you see an intrinsic change in companies? Do you see a real change in companies? Do they believe the stuff that they talk about?
This is a very interesting question, and let me go back to 2005 when I left my private practice to start Operation Asha, serving TB treatment, serving TB patients, the poorest of the poor. At that time, when I started my work, I was discouraged by every single person. My own colleagues, my friends from the hospital and everybody. And they said, what are you doing? There are no funds, and especially for TB. TB is a poor man's disease, nobody's interested. If you want to do charity, why don't you work in HIV/AIDS? Because Gates Foundation is pouring in money in the country. So I said, no, I know this is a much bigger problem and I will work here. Believe it or not, it was an impossible task to get even 5 rupees for a patient, for a TB patient. And my own contacts would give, but give once. And second time they would not take my call. And third time they would tell me, aren't you ashamed of yourself always asking for money? We are disgusted, we are ashamed of you. And that is what's been happening for a long time. Now, my first fundraiser in the US, done by University of Chicago, I was asked by people in the audience, fine, we understand your problem is enormous. It's the biggest public health crisis in the world, TB, no doubt. But what is your own country doing? What is your government doing? And what are so-and-so people doing? And they named the big wigs in the country. And how much money has so-and-so given you? Who has made this and made that? And I had no answer. So it was really, really shameful at that time. I had no answer. Now things are changing, no doubt. Few people are coming forward. But let me explain what I think CSR is all about. CSR is not just corporate social responsibility. It is also civil society responsibility. I think the problem, it's very easy to blame the companies and say they are not giving money for charity. But what are the NGOs doing? Do they have transparency, accountability? Do they have a measurable impact? Can they prove that every paisa given to them goes to the core program? With minimal for overheads, less than say 12 to 15%, that is the international norm. Where is all the money going? The day the NGOs make things clear, I feel things will be better for them. Now in our country, the Global Fund gave $400 million for TB detection and awareness, and not a single patient was detected. The World Bank gave $100 million in 2006, $170 million 2009, another $100 million. But we have the world's biggest burden of TB, 20 lakh new cases every year. So where is all the money going? So I think both parties, and we are not on opposite sides of the fence, all said and done. We are working towards a common goal, but we both have to clean up our acts. The NGOs have to do things better, and the corporates will have to find. Yes, there is change because people are coming forward to say, what are you doing? Tell us about your work. And even if they are giving small amounts, they are interested. They are saying, okay, we will give you money to treat 5 TB patients. Show us the photographs of the patients. We will go and meet the patients. Fine, you do it. But at least something is being done now. At the same time, there are many industries that just want to fulfill their legal responsibility. Sure.
Deepak and Sumantra.
Sure. I think one quick point I would like to make. I think historically, what you say is only partly true, because you go to any nook and corner of the country, you will find the school, college, hospital built by some businessman over there. So I think there is a rich legacy which is there. So the couple of changes which I see which have happened, one, from an individual driven phenomena, it is becoming an institutional phenomena. That is one very clearly visible thing, because once you put this entire decision making as a part, as an integral process of a business, and you embed it over there, you make it mandatory at the board level, by default, the board, the individuals are going to take cognizance of this process. And I can very well share, because when I meet people as an individual, people are very, very forthcoming. They want to do something good for the society. But the moment when you see them in the boardroom, everyone starts asking for a value proposition. So while it is not to say that the asking questions is wrong, it is also to give a framework and put forward a longer term roadmap to what is desirable impact. I think these are really some of the phenomena which is emerging very fast.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So CSR, and my first remark was more about the shared value. CSR in a manner that contribute to the well-being of your communities who are directly impacted by you or who you depend on. Those have been present, and we've got several examples like Deepak was pointed out. I think what is evolving
he
is
left
the...
left out the temples. Okay. You'd find more of temples than you'd find of schools and hospitals.
I guess we've got programs, and of course, things are changing now more so in the last few years, where I think, like Shelley was pointed out, two things that I think more evolved or let's say mature CSR platform, what can they contribute apart from focusing on a few things? Because we keep hearing about the funds of financing. I don't know what will it finally end up at, 10,000 crores or 20,000 crores, whatever that is. But what is it when you look at the sustainable development agenda? So it is not just financing. I think it's more about how does the private sector partner, in a scaling up nonprofit. Use the word, but let's say it is more like a venture capitalist investing into a fund. You look at how do you strengthen that sector, in terms of governance, how do they manage it, how do they become, a little smart about managing KPIs, etc. And the other partner, which is the government, I see that there is a tremendous value add in terms of how you can bring in innovation into certain programs and then hand it over. So we've seen that in our flagship malnutrition projects, etc., that our different approaches can take it as a mission or as a long-term program and then hand it over to the partner. So I think there's much more to it than just financing, and that has to get better and better as we look at these collaborations.
But the interesting thing is we are seeing a lot of interesting experiments even in social financing.
Of course.
The kind of things that are happening in this country now, which is pretty unheard of, right?
Oh, you mean the impact investing, right?
Exactly.
Of course. So I guess the financial sector globally is looking at it both from a broad as well as a core aspect, which means that broad means that as a major stakeholder, they can drive responsible corporate behavior from their investee entities or where they lend to. At the core level, I guess they are diverting capital into such, such projects, including social development projects, which is what we know as impact investing, etc. That's seeing JP Morgan Brexit as a $26 billion opportunity.
That's right, yeah.
But yeah, I think it's still finding its legs, but I think it is gaining ground in India as well. Yeah.
But the question is, and I want Anil to try and answer this, and then others can sort of chip in. How do you build a company that does this? Right? How do you go about making sure that this is part of the company's core? Because that's the only way in which you can ensure that it happens, right? Because
right.
It's not something that can happen because someone's going to come and look at your books or anything else.
Yeah, you can't legalize, right?
Yeah, you can't.
You can't legalize behavior, in a sense.
And tell us how you did it.
Right. Yes. And also, some people are doing because government is saying, some people are doing because also there is a fear about losing the social license to operate. So because your business itself will come into question, right? Because if people protest, you do something just to placate them so that you can continue what you're doing. But I'm going back to basis, fundamental. So if every organization asks a question to itself, why do we exist? Why do I exist, right? What's the philosophy of why do I exist? So then it goes back to when you try and answer that question, your value system comes into place, right? So if you have a right value system, and then when I'm talking of what's the right value system, see, every entrepreneur, every company, every entity who creates wealth with the help of capitalism, you actually draw everything from the society, except your own, brain, brawn, whatever you use, everything else you draw from the society. You are maybe a better and more efficient manager of main material and money compared to a lot of other people. One way or the other, society entrusts that to you, right? You get money from the bank or government gives some subsidies or the customers are willing to buy from you in that sense. So if you look at yourself that I am a custodian of what I am, getting in, I am creating a lot of value. I am going to share some of it for myself, for legacy and for other purposes. But at the end of the day, I need to go back somewhere from where I came from. And this goes back to the society. So I'm merely custodian during that interim period when I'm running the business, creating value, creating growth. And I am not the sole owner of this because this could be done only because of the society existed and I could exist. So in case of our company, my father started with hardly about 7,000 rupees in early 60s. And first two decades of his life, he spent time in terms of dealing with the small farmers. We came from a farming family. And there have been companies and companies which have been selling things to farmers for, literally hundreds of years, right? Fertilizer, chemicals, other things. But nobody of them really bothers to see what impact it creates for their farmers on a sustained basis. And that is the view we took, that we looked at that farmer and we said, I was him, right? And now, if I can be better, I can become better, why he cannot become better? Why he cannot change? And when we looked at that as a value, that it is part what we exist, why we exist, is that we exist to do good for ourselves, but in the process, we must also do good for that farmer, the customer, before we will do good for ourselves. And we have been able to inculcate that kind of value system. We have 10,000 people today. And so it's not just my father, we four brothers, our family, our company. But now this has become a moment. And in a moment, the value creation is the focus. The focus is not to sell or to transact. And when you do transact, as she was saying, you do create certain benefits, right? As a company, you create jobs, somebody will become better because you create jobs. But that is by default. In any transaction, you will create some benefit. I'm talking of creating the structure or DNA of your organization with a focus of doing everything right to start with. Then you don't necessarily need CSR. we still have foundations and so on beyond what we do as a company, you know, in terms of education or whatever else. But that value system, that why do you exist and why do you do what you do, if you take that as a value system, and then along with that also it's important, we have been talking about NGOs and foundations and so on.
What you're speaking of is some sort of larger corporate purpose.
Larger corporate purpose of why you exist as an entity, right? Because that's Aristotle asked that question, right? You know, that's a philosophical question. But I'm saying, now, when you have that right value system, that's a good foundation. But then, if you do not build either scale and or excellence, then you will still fail in what you are proposing to do. The creating that disproportionate positive impact on a sustainable basis, so that even after you are left, even when you don't do anything, things will still continue and, you know, do better.
Exactly.
For much entire value system that has to create that level of a economic impact which has never been done. You know, for 1 rupee you create a 50 rupee value or 100 rupees economy, and that is what through business planning and a right value you can achieve, and that's what we have been trying to
Satya,
do.
Satya, you wanted to say something.
This is the biggest shared value that ancient wisdom gives. The biggest shared value and the only shared value it gives is the ability to see the truth. Now, let me give you an example. Let us say an apple falls from the tree. There are two ways of looking at it. An animal would say food, goes, eats the apple. How should a human being see the truth? He sees food, but he also says, an apple has fallen, it has rolled on the ground and stopped. It has fallen, so it tells you about gravity. Rolling on the ground says, hey, it rolled. It gives you the idea of the wheel. It stopped. It gives you the idea of friction. And then there is food. Then you say, no, within the apple, there is a seed. Now let me watch what happens. From the seed, another tree grows. That is the ancient Indian wisdom, the way of looking at truth. It cannot be taught in a textbook. He comes, his father's value system. It's the way of seeing the truth. How would a corporate look at it? He'll say, 3 years is the term of the CEO. Apple has fallen. Let me maximize. Capitalism is about maximization. The only reason I like Porter is he talks of optimization, not maximization. So the difference between maximization and optimization, let me elaborate a little. He'll say that there is a seed. Now there must be some element of benefit from eating the seed. So some lab will test it, they'll find out it's very good for eating. So you will land up grinding the seed and eating. So all the seeds of all the apples will be eaten, and that will be your USP, and the CEO will maximize result. He says health is improving so much. But after a few years, there will be no more apple trees growing. The population has grown, the apple trees are the same, the number of apples are about the same, plus minus whatever standard deviation. That's what we are doing to the environment. This is what I say, the ability to see the truth. How do you create this ability to see the truth through management education? That is the task. How do you make a person see the truth? For this, we don't have to go to spirituality, we don't have to look at God, we don't have to look at anything like that. We can understand the whole of ancient Indian tradition through Porter's three ingredients of strategy.
Sure. Shali? Quickly, because you can see that.
Very quick comments, yeah. Two comments. First one is, I would agree with you absolutely when you talked of the person at the helm of affairs having certain values. And if these values are of honesty, integrity, truthfulness, hard work, then these percolate down to the entire organization. And that's what shared value is also all about. That this is how the organization grows, because they know you will not tolerate substandard work. And the second comment I want to make is that capitalism doesn't mean selfishness. And we have to move beyond self-interest to the interest of all. And when we start thinking, and someone as a leader of the company starts thinking of the common good, then that is, I think you had also commented on that, but that is what shared value and ancient wisdom is all about.
Great. We're going to stop now. We're not going to take questions because we're out of time. I hope that's fine, right?
And thank you so much, everybody, for participating in such a free and frank manner.